Hello and welcome to this very special interview. I'm in conversation today with the Managing Director and CEO of Asia's oldest exchange, the Bombay Stock Exchange, Ashish Kumar Chauhan. Thank you very much for talking to Bloomberg TV. My first question, Ashish, very recently we celebrated 25 years of SEBI. And at that point of time, it was a good time to reflect on where our markets had come. And I don't think there was anyone who had a view that we haven't progressed the way we did. Whether you talk about stock exchanges, the depository, the settlement, even the regulatory framework. But one thing that has always bothered me is that when we talk about being able to penetrate into our markets in terms of going deeper into getting more and more Indians into the stock market, we seem to be still where we were probably 10 years ago, if you look at the unique identity numbers that are getting generated across exchanges. As someone who's been part of that 25-year journey in multiple roles, let's talk future. What is it that we need to do to bring people back?
You know, I would agree. In a sense, a lot has been done in sort of last 25 years. India has come a long way in many areas, including in securities markets. Much more needs to be done. So basically, one of the biggest issues has been about the penetration, and somewhere on the line, I reflect back to my telecom days, although they were sort of in last decade, and similar debate people used to have on how do you kind of penetrate telecom, because telecom had the ability to increase the GDP growth by a large margin. And we were not able to do it because we could blame policies, we could blame execution. For me, some of these situations would also have technological solutions. When a solution arrives, you won't even know. And of course, that doesn't mean that we don't have to do what is correct within the current technological framework.
Let me go back to the telecom example you gave. One of the reasons, Ashish, that we saw the inflection point in telecom and the explosion was because tariffs came down. When it started, tariffs were high. We kept on seeing them coming down, and then finally the inflection point happened. But again, if we compare that to markets, to our, the equivalent of it would be the brokerage rates or the cost of transactions, they've also come down significantly, isn't it? You talk to, in fact, most brokers today, they say there is no money to be made in the brokerage. Yet we've not seen the inflection point. So when you say technology, and I know you've been a very keen technology person as well, so what is that technology which is going to change? I mean, are you saying that when the newer mobile technologies emerge, whether we are talking of now 4G and even 3G is just stabilizing, could that be the trigger where people will then be able to transact through their phones? Because we've seen the cost equation is pretty much, you know, we probably are one of the cheapest markets in the world for transactions, isn't it?
In a sense, I think there are two aspects to this cost conundrum. One is when you take a look at the cost, it has several parts. One is what the broker gets himself, but one is what the consumer pays. And there, basically, the costs have increased in total, or cost has remained similar over the last 25 years because of the newer set of taxes that have come in. And overall tax incidence has also improved. In a sense, the tax collection methodologies have improved. So overall, if you see the total cost, in a sense,
to the investor,
it may have remained similar or might have come down.
Some came down and others
have gone up. So that could be one of the reasons. But for me, investments has to be separated from what I call trading. I think somewhere on the line, what I would like to focus on as a capital markets is more on capital formation, on investments, on giving longer term returns, on training or sort of telling people to stay invested for longer term, select right areas. And so instead of doing trading on a very regular basis, although you may be having information on regular basis.
Today we are in a situation, Ashish, which is unprecedented, where perhaps for the first time we have foreign institutional investors. A, of course, they are at the all-time highs in terms of their ownership. Simultaneously, what has happened is we've seen a lack of participation in mutual funds, insurance, etc. So the dominance that has happened, and it's a matter of concern because there are a lot of experts out there, market experts out there, who talk in terms of the fact that we are so dominant on FIIs that even if a small amount of it was to go away, because there is no internal support in that sense. How serious is this situation according to you?
For me, again, it moves through a cycle. I mean, in the last 20 years or 22 years, I have seen probably four cycles. There is a time when the markets go down and the investors kind of try to go away from that market, and then the market starts giving results which are good on a consistent basis. Then investors go into that market more often. So for me, I have developed this theory of what I call investors chase returns. Investors chase past returns, and they tend to believe that the past return will get repeated over the future, and that's where they try to go into the fund manager who has given better returns in the past. They tend to get into an asset class which has given good returns in the past, and so it has happened in by work of fate or accident or due to the business cycles. Over last 5-6 years, you have seen the more returns have come from other asset classes like gold, silver, real estate, and the commodity cycle in a sense was going up, and the stock market cycle had kind of stayed where it was, and so people were chasing past returns. So I keep on asking these questions to investors across the country, saying you want to invest in gold, it has given say four times the returns in so many years, would it become four times more in next 5 years? And then they start realizing that no, it has now plateaued or it has kind of gone down. Similarly, in real estate, it has already gone up probably 10 times in last 10 years. Would it go up 10 times in next 10 years? Again, then it brings people to the reality that now, because of the way the economy is now sort of behaving, I have huge hopes that the investment in the stock markets is going to give you much more returns because of the way the cycles seem to be now going in a different way vis-a-vis what you have seen in last 5-6 years.
You earlier on used the word trust in a different context. My question to you is, Ashish, there is a general feeling among investors, and in fact, even the Prime Minister recently commented on it, that perhaps more efforts need to be made to curb insider trading. While on many other fronts, our regulations seem to have worked, but the general feeling is that insider trading is still rampant. This question is more because you are also the first line regulator, so to speak. Is that an area, according to you, where we seem to have failed and we haven't done much?
Again, I would put it in a different way, saying 25 years back, people were not aware. In a sense, insider trading is one of the last bastions of the capital markets. There were what I call easier, more identifiable malpractices by corporates, which have slowly been kind of controlled by way of regulations, by way of behavior, by way of market actually, in a sense, rewarding good behavior and not rewarding bad behavior. Because of various reasons, those malpractices have actually been reduced drastically. And if you look at Indian regulations 25 years back, if you look at them now, if you look at the behavior and even the newspaper stories in those days vis-a-vis now, you will see a huge difference. So for me, India has come a long way. But if you ask me, is it enough? I would say we have a long way to go, right? So somewhere what has been achieved cannot be that impact cannot be reduced. At the same time, the insider trading comes into play only if other areas kind of go down, other malpractice which are large gross malpractices, they go down. And now that they have gone down, we have started becoming more aware of the insider trading related issues. Now, how do we...
But you believe there are enough incidents happening out there and therefore more steps need to be taken?
Absolutely. I mean, for me, as I said, this what do the markets produce, right? Even what is a financial instrument? It is basically connecting the future with the current, right? You are putting money and you are connecting into future. There is, in reality, there is nothing that connects future with current, and that is a leap of faith, right? That is a leap of trust. When you invest in something, you know that my money will come back with certain returns, or
at least there's no scam,
right? And so for me, that faith has to be maintained, that trust has to be maintained. For example, I again give my sort of a small example. A person sitting in Jammu, a housewife sitting in Jammu, if she is investing her hard-earned money in a company in Salem, she is not going to probably visit the company for rest of her life. But she has that comfort, and she has to have that comfort, and authorities, including the exchanges and everyone else, has to give that comfort, saying that your interests will be taken care of, that nobody will take away the money which belongs to you, which legitimately is yours, right? And that portion of it, we need to do a lot of work. We have done a lot. I'm pretty comfortable saying that in 25 years, we have done a lot. We still have a long way to go, because there are going to be incidents, there are going to be additional activities which we currently are not concentrating on, may also sort of come up, which we are currently not saying are big enough, may become big enough later on. The other part is, for me, if you look at the markets and the investments, there are two clearly distinct aspects to that. One is what we call trading part of it, that is trading, clearing, settlement. So it's a transaction processing part of it. Another is the investment part of it. That is, once you have bought, the transaction is over, you have bought the shares, it is now in your account, and that is what where the corporate governance comes into place. So in some sense, we have moved very fast in the transaction processing part of it. We have sort of reformed it completely. Technology has helped, technical changes have helped, and so we have reformed it completely. What used to take probably 2 days to get a confirmation for your trade is now happening in few milliseconds. Whereas the corporate governance part of it,
you're disappointed?
No, I won't say I'm disappointed.
The quality of corporate governance?
I would say, again, I would reiterate that India has come a long way. Indian corporates are much more sort of inclined. And
are you satisfied?
No, I am not satisfied. As I said, we need to work a lot. And it is not only to sort of say anything about the corporates. It's also about the overall framework that we need to create a rewarding mechanism.
You talked about algorithmic trading earlier, Ashish. When one looks at the numbers of the top 5 or 10 brokerages or traders in this country, you find most of that list today comprises of these algorithmic traders. They're huge volumes. Is that something healthy? Because, you know, again, we've had some incidents of breakdowns of stock exchange infrastructure, the flash crashes, etc. But is that a healthy practice that you have so much amount of volumes as a percentage? I'm sure it's an international thing. It happens world over. What is your own view? I know that you worked closely with SEBI as an exchange, come out with certain regulations. Have you seen some kind of a tempering of that? Because we've seen, our own investigations have shown, one little shop sitting there, one room in any part of this country, pumping in millions and millions of rupees of trades. Is that a healthy trend for India?
See, again, this is to be looked at in a different context, you know. I think there are two, three sort of strands of thoughts which comes to my mind when I discuss this issue in a conceptual way. One is what I call internationally, because the speed, when you are talking about, say, a microsecond vis-a-vis an investment horizon of a year, or a year or 2 or 5 years or 20 years, it's a very different context vis-a-vis sort of what used to happen on floor-based trading and so on and so forth. So that is one piece of puzzle that needs to be solved. And the question that comes out of it, which is slightly more fundamental, is that are the markets, stock market specifically, and this is not only an Indian question or question being asked in India, its question being debated completely internationally, saying, are the exchanges basically for capital formation and long-term investments, or are they basically places for trading too fast, too soon, right? And for me, there is no right answer, because any new technology that comes, there will be questions that will be raised. The past, in a sense, is accepted. Only what comes gets questioned. And the way I look at it is, as a society, we have to be slightly open and try to harness what is good that is coming out of this, and sort of try to stop what bad can happen.
And a lot of bad has already happened.
In a sense, if you look at the history of very many things, for example, vehicles. I remember a movie called Naya Daur. I don't know whether you remember, right? It won President's Medal also. And it was basically a story of technology change, how it affects the surroundings. And on that particular movie, the old technology won, but that was basically the Tonga horse cart. And but
so,
after
so you
that,
believe algorithmic trading is here to stay?
For me,
and
that
it doesn't bother you if 90% of the top brokers of this country are algorithmic players.
See, for
you're
me,
okay with that.
For me, I have to look at it saying, how do I harness their activity to do good for rest of the market? So that what happens is, if I stall them, if I stop them, that is one way to do it. But that may also have its own repercussions, because then it may go underground and you are not able to even sort of regulate them. And for me, what SEBI has done is phenomenally sort of impressive, in a sense that they are one of the early movers in this area. They have figured out the right way to regulate. They have also imposed specific fines and so on.
Has that worked?
I think it has worked. And also, experiences are evolving the systems within the algo trading firms, within exchanges, within SEBI. And so somewhere on the line, over a period, the way the automated trading came from floor, similar questions were asked, I can assure you.
There's a lot of excitement around your impending IPO, and I know you're probably asked this question wherever you go. But there are issues in terms of the guidelines laid down by SEBI, in the sense that it would probably render many of your board members not even eligible, and I'm sure there would be many other issues you would be grappling with. When is a reasonable time frame for this?
See, the way I look at it is, I have been told by my investment bankers to not speak the IPO in public. So I'll apologize for this, but effectively we are working on it, and as and when we are able to sort of go in the right way and right time, we should be able to sort of come out with IPO.
Is there place for three stock exchanges in this country?
Again, for me, there are...
As a country, just to put this into perspective, I am asking you this. We had, at some point of time, more than 25 exchanges, right? We took a long, long time to find a way out to consolidate, and at the end of it, it became two exchanges. We now have a third exchange. Given the current state in which all that we've discussed in the last half hour, that we are not even getting that number of people coming into this market, is there scope?
Yeah, again, for me, I would ask several other questions which are related to this, because what happens is...
So why don't you ask?
Yeah, when we look at an issue and we ask a simplistic question, below that there are many what I call philosophical issues that need to be debated. So where that you come to the answer for that simple issue, which is the crux. So one of the questions is, when telecom was a natural monopoly, setting up another telecom company to compete with DoT would have been very difficult, and in some sense may not have been possible. But when more telecom companies, when technology changed, more telecom companies could actually come in at much lower capital sort of expense, capex, then you started having sort of seeing them more and more, and that same debate had happened, that whether DoT should do this or private guys should do this, and so on and so forth. That is one set of questions, that when technologies change, earlier technology was basically floor for a stock exchange. And you couldn't have too many floors. And that's where there was a need to kind of aggregate this liquidity into a single floor. And then there is another issue about the exchange's role as a public utility. That what is the role of an exchange? I mean, role of a telecom company now are very clear that it's basically a service provider. They don't have that type of social relevance vis-a-vis a stock exchange that has, because it is actually it is trading people's investments. It is creating that trust, and if it becomes a profit only for profit oriented sort of organization, it may have severe other repercussions on the trust formation itself. And trust is a very, what I call, very fine thing. If you lose it once, it may not affect you only, it may affect the entire system. So that's why that debate, I still think, has happened, but that needs to reach to a conclusion at some point in time. The third thing that comes out of that trust question is, if you allow more players, what do you need to look for? Because when you are running trust markets, a nation's wealth today, $1.3 trillion or more are listed on BSE. In some sense, the enormity of BSE's market capitalization is not understood by people in sort of street. But just to give you a perspective, the BSE's market cap is larger than all banks, all assets put together. Effectively, in last 138 years, you have created $1.3 trillion of wealth by having that trust markets. And we have gone through our what I call lessons, and we have learnt out of each issues that came up in the market, and we have kind of reformed and gone into a direction. Getting newer people who may be profit motivated, who may have a different what I call moral characteristics, to allow them to run these markets, which are inherently trust markets, would that be sort of feasible? So for me, there are several questions within one, but if you also experience what is happening elsewhere in the world, there are countries which are merging markets. For example, Japan is merging Osaka and Tokyo Stock Exchange. Even Russia merged two of their exchanges. At the same time, Japan is also allowing newer what we call trading activities using electronic framework. US, lot of things are merging, lot of exchanges are merging, but lot of newer trading models are coming up. I have been told there are almost 140, 150 total marketplaces in America as of now. Newer exchanges which are very large worldwide coming up, Kayaks, BATS, and so on and so forth. So it may look like confusing situation. India, in the way it is sort of currently in its developmental path, and also the societal sort of current framework, what is it that it needs to do within sort of the realm of all these questions that I asked, is for me only after 10 years or 15 years we can debate the decisions we take today, whether they were sort of correct decisions or not. But I'm sure with good thing about democracy is we can, we take a long time, we debate, discuss, blame a lot of people, but finally we end up coming to the right decision.
You've said a lot without trying to say anything. All right. Thank you very much, Ashish. A pleasure talking
to you.
Thank
you, sir. Thank you.